Happy Good Friday, everybody. Welcome to Peace Evangelical and Reformed Church. And does anybody know why we call this Good Friday? Because this is the day we celebrate Jesus dying on the cross for our sins. That's why it's Good Friday, because Jesus was so good to us on this day long ago. And that's what we're celebrating here today. And as we begin our worship service, just a couple of announcements to highlight. I just want to thank all those who prepared and provided all the yummy soups. I didn't get a chance to eat all 15 of them yet. Still got about 12 or 13 to go, but ones I had were delicious. Thank you so much for doing that. We appreciate that. And for all those who went to tables and poured milk and chocolate milk and refills on drinks, much appreciated. One other announcement, we're going on a trip. We're going on an ARC encounter Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, July 24th through 26th. If you get in a $100 deposit to Paula Johnson soon, there's still some seats available. I think we have 33 that are going. I think we need three more to secure the bus of 36 people, but we can take up to 45 people because they have 45-seater buses. And it's going to be an awesome time, and we'll go down to the Ark Museum, we'll see the Creation Museum, and maybe we'll get to meet Noah. No, I'm just kidding about that. But it'll be a great time and a great learning experience. And also, you may want to check the bulletin for any local times and listings that may affect you the most specifically. We'll just begin now with a word of prayer. God, we love you so much, and we love what you did for us on the cross 2,000 years ago. And we thank you, Lord. We know you didn't have to do it. You could have stayed up in heaven and had unfettered fellowship with the Father, but you chose to come down here and be reviled and ridiculed and punished and killed on the cross to pay the price for our sins. You loved us even more than your own relationship with the Father. How can we say thank you enough for your great love for us? But we do want to dedicate the service to you. Amen. Let's stand together. We'll sing number 255. Jesus paid it all. We didn't pay anything toward our salvation. Jesus paid it all. Number 255. Thank you. Apostles' Creed, found in the back of the songbook on the right side and also on the screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And at this time, we have a special music presentation from the Potter's Clay. Thank you, Potter's Clay. I love that part of the song where the Father says to Jesus, I'm so proud of you. It just gives me chills. I love that. Great job. Thank you so much. Our scripture reading for this afternoon comes from John's Gospel, John chapter 18. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was an olive grove, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas came to the grove, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it that you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas the traitor was standing there with them. When Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" They said, "Jesus of Nazareth." "I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so the words he had spoken will be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those that you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" And then moving on to John chapter 19, verse 25. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that all was now completed and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." And with this, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. This is the inspired word of God. And may the Lord add his blessing to the reading and the listening and the teaching and the preaching and the application of the word of God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the scriptures. And I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be faithful to the scriptures. In Jesus' name, amen. There was a lawyer sitting at his desk in his brand new office, and he saw a man coming down the hall toward his office, his first customer in his new office, and so he wanted to look important, like a man in command and in control. So he picked up the phone and said, "Yes, Mr. President." "Thank you, Mr. President." "Oh, I agree. If you don't say anything for a week, I'm sure this will blow over." "Thank you very much, Mr. President." Puts the phone down and says to the man, "How can I help you?" The man says, "I'm from Verizon. I'm here to hook up your phone." We want people to think that we're in command. We got everything under control. We don't need someone to tell us what to do. We don't need God. We don't need the church. We don't need to be preached to. We don't need to be convicted. But as we read today's text dealing with Holy Thursday and Good Friday, we see that there's really only one person in control. There's only one person in command. Even on Holy Thursday and Good Friday, the only person who was orchestrating all the events was the Lord Jesus Christ. And so as we go through the scriptures on Holy Thursday and also dealing with Good Friday, I want to challenge you to let go of any aspirations you may have toward power and prominence and prestige and command and control in your life, and lay that down at the feet of Christ and let him take control. At the end of John chapter 17, Jesus prays for his disciples, and he prays for those who will believe in the gospel because of their preaching. Then in chapter 18, verse 1, when he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. It's interesting that in 2 Samuel chapter 15, verse 13, David crossed the Kidron Valley to get away from his betrayers. Jesus crosses the Kidron Valley to confront his betrayers. So already in just that little verse, we see the command and control and the confidence of the Lord Jesus Christ to deal with the conflict that lies ahead. Also, as he's crossing the valley, he would have seen the pipes coming from the Jerusalem temple, draining the blood of the Passover sacrifices into the Kidron Ravine. And so as he and the disciples are walking toward the Garden of Gethsemane, they see this blood in the ravine, and it's a visual reminder that Jesus himself is about to be the Passover sacrifice that is slaughtered for the sins of the world. The image of the blood is unmistakable, pointing in that direction. It says also in verse 1 there was an olive grove, and he and his disciples went into it. Now we know from Matthew, Mark, and Luke that this olive grove is called Gethsemane. And it's interesting that in the book of Genesis, God the Father is betrayed by Adam and Eve in a garden. Here, God the Son is being betrayed by descendants of Adam and Eve. So the same thing is happening again, except to the Son. Verse 2 says, now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with the disciples. Just as God desired a close walk and relationship with Adam and Eve in the garden, the Lord Jesus Christ desires a close relationship with his disciples in the garden. And it says that Judas came to the grove, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. It's very important to notice that you've got both Jewish people and Gentile people. The soldiers are Gentile. The officials are from the chief priests and from the Pharisees. John is saying you cannot pin the persecution and punishment and crucifixion of Jesus Christ solely on the Jewish people. Gentiles and Jewish people were responsible for the monstrous, horrible way that Christ was treated. And later New Testament texts tell us that it was our sins that sent Jesus Christ to the cross. Well, how do I know that? 1 Corinthians 15, verse 3, Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. He was buried. On the third day, he was raised again according to the scriptures. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 24, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were like sheep going astray, but now you have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. 1 Peter 3:18, for Christ died for our sins once and for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. 1 John 3:5, for you know that he appeared in order to take away sin, and in him is no sin. I got one more verse. Revelation 1, verse 5, to him who loved us and freed us from our sins by his blood, so that we can be a kingdom of priests to serve his God and Father. To him be glory and power in the church forever and ever. Amen. Now, the sin of the Gentile and Jewish people was their desire for power, prominence, prestige, command, and control above everything else. Jesus was okay as a little baby lying in the manger, but they didn't want an adult Jesus saying things like, go and sell everything you have and give to the poor and you'll have treasure in heaven, then come follow me. They didn't want an adult Jesus saying, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. They wanted to retain the status quo and keep the peace with Rome and keep Jesus out of the way. They had no room for Jesus Christ. Doesn't that sound like the Christmas story? Remember in Luke, it says there was no room for him in the inn? And it's interesting that at the end of his ministry, the people still do not have room for Jesus Christ. Reading on at the end of verse 3, it says that the people coming to arrest and arraign Jesus were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Now you remember earlier in the book of John, chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus says, I am the light of the world. How ironic that you have to go looking for the light of the world with torches and lamps and lanterns. What's going on with that? John is trying to tell us that both literally and spiritually, people are in the dark about the identity of Jesus Christ. How many of you are afraid of the dark? One time, I see a couple of hands, even an adult, two adults. One time I was working out in the basement. I don't work out that much anymore, you can probably tell. But while I was down there, I don't know what happened, but there was a power outage, and it was completely dark. There were no windows in the basement. I couldn't even see my hand in front of my face. I was scared. You know how I made it back to the steps and upstairs to the first floor? Very, very slowly. I can't imagine living life or in eternity completely in the dark. But that's what John is trying to tell us about people who cannot see that Jesus is Lord. They cannot see that he is the Savior and the Son of God. They cannot see that he is the great I Am that knocks people down with the sheer power of his person and his presence. They are living in the dark literally, and someday, if they continue to reject Jesus Christ to their dying breath, they'll be in blackest darkness forever, according to 2 Peter chapter 2. Now, Jesus knows that this is going down. He knows this is the situation, because John 18, verse 4, Jesus knowing all that was going to happen to him. He's in control. He's in command. He knows what's going on. He went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. Now, the expression in Greek, "I am he," is ego eimi. And we see it over and over again in the book of John. Jesus says, "Ego eimi, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener." And also, what's interesting about that expression, it's also used of God, the Father, in the Old Testament. In Exodus chapter 3, verse 15, God says, "I am who I am." So Jesus is not only saying, "I am he, Jesus of Nazareth," he is saying, "I am the great I Am of the Old Testament. I am God." And people are stunned at the power and presence of Christ, because it says in verse 6, when Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. That reminds me of a scene from the movie Gladiator. Remember, Marcus Aurelius was emperor of Rome, and I believe Maximus was supposed to be next in line to be emperor, but Commodus kills Marcus Aurelius, and he has Maximus thrown in prison, and he thinks he got rid of him. But Maximus escapes, and years later, he faces off against his nemesis, except his nemesis doesn't recognize him because it's been a few years. And he says to him, "Who are you?" And he says, "I am Maximus, the son of Marcus Aurelius, and I will have my revenge in this life or in the next." And this was in the middle of an auditorium, and the crowd is screaming and cheering. But the emperor is so stunned by the true identity of Maximus that he staggers backwards. That's what we have here. People are so stunned and shocked at the sheer person and deity and divinity and awesomeness of Christ that they stagger back. And Jesus says again, "Who is it you want?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." You know, they don't want the great I am who knocks people over with his power and presence and love. They want a watered-down Jesus of Nazareth that they can knock over. They want somebody that they can take control of and take custody of. But remember, the Lord Jesus Christ is in control of this situation. He says, I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, then let these men go. And this fulfilled a scripture that he had spoken earlier. I have not lost one of those that you gave me. John 6, verse 39. And then Simon Peter is thinking, well, this isn't the way it's supposed to go. We're supposed to not get arrested. We're supposed to take over, man. I'm not ready for this. And so he whips out his sword and he slices off the servant of the high priest's ear. And that's when Jesus gives him an earful. That was a joke. And Jesus says, put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup of adversity and affliction and suffering that the Father has given to me? So even here, people don't want to accept Jesus as he is, the great I am. And we see that as we move now from Holy Thursday into Good Friday. Chapter 19, verses 1 through 3, they put on him a crown of thorns, and they mock him, Hail, King of the Jews! And they beat him, and they whip him. And then moving on down to verse 17, they lead him off to be crucified. And they take him to the cross, and they lay him on the wood. And as soon as Christ is laid upon the wood, the sins of the entire world that have ever been committed or ever will be committed are laid upon him. And he literally becomes sin for us. 2 Corinthians 5:21. And he's nailed to the wood. And then Jesus ministers from the cross. He says to his mother, behold your son. He says to John, behold your mother. And then verse 30, when Jesus was finished with his work on the cross, he said, it is finished. Now notice he didn't say, I am finished, because he was just getting started. Die on the cross for our sins, rise from the dead, ascend into heaven, pour out the Holy Spirit, plead our case, dispense his grace, welcome sinners saved by grace, and continue his ministry. He's just getting going. And he doesn't say, we are finished because we didn't do nothing. We have nothing to do with our salvation. I think it was Dr. D.L. Moody who said that the thief on the cross, he couldn't move his hands to do anything to earn his salvation. He couldn't take his feet off the cross to go to Sunday school and earn his salvation. All he could do is say, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And that's what happened. Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. And Jesus completed the work of our salvation. I heard a story about a boy who was acting up in public school to the point where he couldn't be at the school anymore. So his father took him out and put him in a Catholic school. And after a few weeks, he got a report from the nuns that instead of being a mischievous student, he had become a model student. And the father couldn't believe that a change could happen that quick. So he said to his son, you were such a mischievous student. How did you become a model student? And he said, well, I was going to act up at the Catholic school just like I acted up at the public school. But then when I got there, I saw a statue of this man nailed to that piece of wood. And I said, wow, this school means business. I better behave myself. When God sent Jesus to die on the cross, he meant business, to pay the price for our sins. And then he rose again to conquer not only sin, but conquer death, proving that there is an afterlife and there is a glorious future for the kingdom of God. So don't believe the fake news that your problems are never going to get any better. The good news is that through faith in the crucified and risen Jesus Christ, there can be healing, there can be hope, there can be salvation, and the assurance that there are better days ahead. This morning when I was just waking up and shaking off the cobwebs, Jeannie had a podcast of John Stone Street's Breakpoint playing. And it was so good. I said, Jeannie, I got to put this at the end of my sermon. And so I put it on the piece of paper. And this is what Stone Street said this morning in his podcast. The first Adam yielded to temptation in a garden. The last Adam, Jesus Christ, defeated temptation in the garden. The first man, Adam, sought to become like God. The last Adam, Jesus Christ, was God, who became a man. The first Adam was naked and received clothing. The last Adam had clothing, but was stripped. The first Adam tasted death from a tree. The last Adam tasted death on a tree. The first Adam hid his face from God. The last Adam begged God not to hide his face from him. The first Adam blamed his bride. The last Adam took the blame for his bride. The first Adam earns thorns and thistles as his punishment. The last Adam wore thorns and thistles as a crown of thorns. The first Adam gained a wife when God opened man's side, but the last Adam gained a wife when man opened God's side, when they thrust the spear into his side, John 19, 36 and 38. The first Adam brought a curse. The last Adam became a curse. The first Adam fell because he listened to the serpent say, take and eat. The last Adam, Jesus Christ, told his followers, take and eat. This is my body. These parallels demonstrate the complete command and control and authority of Jesus Christ over his own passion. So stop trying to be in control. God is the one who's in control. He's the one who orchestrates the events of heaven and earth. And I encourage you to turn your life over to Jesus Christ. He loves you so much. He didn't have to come down here and die for your sins. He could have hung out in heaven for all eternity, but he loved you too much to do that. And he intervened and said, I will take the hit for you on the cross. Give your life to the one who gave his life for you. Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Amen. Our song of worship is number 254. Oh, how he loves you and me. He gave his life. What more could he give? That's the song they have on John MacArthur's Grace to You. I love that song. Number 254. Good singing. Now, this is the part of the Good Friday service where I take prayer requests. Do we have any special requests? Of course, we're going to pray for the United States of America, pray for our leaders, You know, 1 Timothy 2:1, Paul says, I urge, therefore, that requests, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for everyone. But then he specifies kings and all those in authority. So we'll definitely do that. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. And God, we love you very much. And we thank you for Good Friday. It's so much better than Black Friday. Because Good Friday is the day that the God of the universe was good to us. And Lord, we thank you that you're good to us every day. But this is special because we want to remember the sacrifice. Thank you, Jesus, that you who knew no sin became sin on our behalf that we might become the righteousness of God in you. I just want to pray for all the unspoken requests around the congregation. There were no specific vocalized prayer requests, but it's hard to believe in a congregation our size that there aren't needs. We all need God every single day. And so I pray for all those who are dealing with stress and anxiety. Good Friday doesn't feel like a Good Friday today because of something that you're going through at school or something you're going through in a relationship or something you're going through at work. And Lord, I pray for them that they would be able to lay these burdens at the foot of the cross and experience peace and grace and forgiveness and restoration. Lord, we pray for our leaders. We pray that you would give them wisdom to make wise choices. Sometimes it's hard to know what those choices are. So we pray that you would put good people around them. We pray, Lord, for our nation. Jeremiah 29, verse 7 and 8 says that we should pray for the city we live in because if it prospers, we prosper. So we want to do that. We pray for our community. And Lord, we also want to pray for the Easter services this weekend. Pastors are going to be preparing messages challenging people to trust in the risen Christ. And just pray, Lord, for your blessing on all our area pastors and on the crosswalk that we're going to be doing a little later this afternoon. Most of all, God, we thank you for Jesus himself, who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well, as the ushers come forward, we'll take up the afternoon offering. Almost said morning. I just kind of locked in that way.